Dear students, to understand the thermal radiation further, we need the knowledge of some basics. So let us learn those first. See, here in the hot sun, a table is kept, and over the table a white object, a metal block, and another metal block which is painted in black. Both are kept on the surface of the table. See, on both, the incident energy per second is, say, suppose 10 joules. So here, this is not painted black, this is white. So here it will absorb some 2 joules of heat energy, and the remaining 8 joules will be reflected. Whereas when we consider the black painted black, it will absorb around 8 joules of energy, and the remaining 2 joules will be reflected. In this way, absorption to some extent depends upon the color of the object. And if you find an object in that every second some 10 joules of heat energy is incident, and it has absorbed all the heat energy and nothing is reflected, then you can say that object as black body. Now let us define the black body. A body completely absorbing the radiation of all wavelengths falling on it is called a black body. See, the incident radiation will have different wavelengths, and the body which absorbs all wavelengths totally, that is called as a black body. Let me read the definition once again. A body completely absorbing the radiation of all wavelengths falling on it is called a black body. But such bodies are difficult to find in nature. Some examples are given. Carbon black and platinum black approximately behave like a black body, but their absorptivity is less than 1 in the far infrared region. But we can construct a device whose properties are very much close to a black body. We can provide with a small hole to a completely enclosed cavity. See, this is a spherical shaped cavity. The radiation enters into the cavity through the hole and undergoes multiple reflections inside the cavity. Small amounts of energy are absorbed upon successive reflections, and entire radiation of any wavelength will be absorbed. See, this is a spherical shaped cavity, and through this small hole a radiation enters and it falls on the wall. When it falls on the wall, a part of the incident radiation is absorbed and the remaining is reflected. It again falling at another place on the wall. And here again a part of incident energy is absorbed and the remaining reflected. So in this way, after several reflections, all the energy is absorbed by the walls. So no part of the radiation will again come out through the hole. So now we can say this cavity a black body. There is a self-assessment question. Is a black body black? No. Blackness refers to ideal property of absorbing all the radiation incident on the body. Our eyes are only sensitive to visible light. If the body absorbs all the radiation, it is described as the black body. A black body could appear possibly as red, white, or any color depending on its temperature. Now let us consider Prevost's theory of heat exchanges. According to Prevost's theory, every body emits thermal radiation at all temperatures above absolute zero and exchanges heat energy with surroundings. See, in this statement, there are two points. One is, a body emits thermal radiation at all temperatures. We usually think only a hot body emits thermal radiation, not like that. A body at room temperature, a body at 0 degrees centigrade. See here, let us see a diagram here. Previously we have drawn this diagram, pressure versus temperature graph. See, as temperature decreases, pressure also decreases, and it becomes zero at the temperature -273.15°C. And this -273.15°C is taken as 0 Kelvin by the scientist Kelvin, and he prepared an absolute scale. His absolute scale starts at this temperature, and this is called as 0K. 0K means -273.15. See, this temperature has got a lot more importance. What is that importance? If we consider a solid consists of, a solid is a rigid body. The atoms inside a solid do not move from one place to another place like in fluids, but the atoms inside a solid are as if they are connected, interconnected by a spring. See, when you move we consider this spring ball model when in the lesson elasticity, the mechanical properties of solids. In that lesson we had a spring ball model. So here the atoms at room temperature, the solid atoms vibrate about their mean position. When we supply some heat energy, after absorbing the heat energy, these atoms vibrate with large amplitude. That means when temperature is increased, they vibrate with large amplitude, and as you decrease, as you go on decreasing the temperature, the amplitude of the vibration also decreases. And as the temperature is decreased to -273.15°C, then the solid atoms stop vibrating. When the solid atoms are vibrating, then thermal radiation is radiated from that body. Thermal radiation comes out. If the atoms vibrate at large temperature, they vibrate with large amplitude, and more energy is radiated. And as you decrease the temperature, the atoms vibrate with less amplitude, therefore they radiate less energy. So if you go on decreasing the temperature to -273.15°C, then they stop vibrating. Then they stop giving out thermal radiation also. That's why in the Prevost theory, the scientist Prevost mentions that every body emits thermal radiation at all temperatures above absolute zero and exchanges. You see, up to here we have seen, see, -273.15 degrees at this temperature, no vibration, no thermal radiation. -273.15 degrees centigrade means 0 Kelvin, but above the temperature, above 0 Kelvin temperature, the body atoms will be vibrating, therefore thermal radiation will be there. So in his theory, that is the first point. Every body emits thermal radiation at all temperatures above absolute zero. Next point is, and exchanges heat energy with surroundings. Now let us consider exchange of heat energy with the surroundings. Now let us consider an example. Hot teacup is kept on a table. So the boiled tea was poured into a cup. It means it is at a temperature of 100 degrees centigrade. So the body is at 100 degrees centigrade. It is kept on a table, and around the teacup there is surroundings, and the surrounding temperature, that is room temperature, is say some 27 degrees centigrade. Now what happens in case of conduction, or in case of conduction, what we told, heat flows from higher temperature region to lower temperature region. So here, but the here we are considering radiation. So here what happens? So here what happens? So now this is a hot body, and this is a surrounding is at lower temperature. So this hot body emits thermal radiation. This hot teacup emits thermal radiation. How long it emits radiation? So now, but here one important thing we have to consider according to Prevost theory. See, the hot teacup is at 100 degrees centigrade, and this is above 0 K, or see, this is in centigrade, no? Well, let me write, this is above -273.15 degrees centigrade. Therefore, according to Prevost theory, it should emit thermal radiation. Okay. Now, surrounding. See, the surrounding air is at 27 degrees centigrade, and this is also above the absolute zero. This is also above the absolute zero. So this also emits radiation. It means, according to this theory, both are emitting radiations. But here, in the second part, what he says, there is exchange of heat energy. What does it mean? A hot body radiates, emits the thermal radiation. At the same time, it also receives the thermal radiation. But the rate of emission is more, and the rate of absorption is less. So that on a net, when you consider net value, the net value will be of emission. Suppose you consider the emission of the energy positive, and you consider absorption of the energy as negative, and when you calculate the net value, that net value will be positive. It means what? Overall, it will be radiating. So one important thing you have understood, what is that? Whether it is a hot body or cold body. See, a body in general emits the thermal radiation, at the same time absorbs the thermal radiation. But for a hot body, rate of emission is large and rate of absorption is less. Similarly, for a body at lower temperature, rate of emission is less and rate of absorption is more. Okay, now this hot teacup is kept on a table, and how long will it be at 100 degrees centigrade? Only for some time. After some time, it cools down and it reaches the room temperature. Okay, suppose it has reached the room temperature. Now both are at same temperature. This teacup is at 27 degree centigrade and surrounding area is also at 27 degree centigrade. Now what do you say? So body and surroundings both are in thermal equilibrium with each other. And here he uses one key word, that is, he says it is dynamic equilibrium. When body temperature is equal to surrounding temperature, the body emits and receives heat at same rate, and then the body will be under dynamic equilibrium with the surrounding. So in case of solids, we have considered heat conduction, and there we defined, we derived an expression for a rate of heat flow, that is Q by T. Q by T means what? The energy transferred, the heat energy transferred in a second, in unit time. Q by T means the heat energy transferred in unit time. Q by T or H. Q by T or H. These stand for rate of heat flow or heat current. And we derived an expression like KATC minus TD by L, like this. So this is for conduction. And in case of fluids, in fluids, the heat transfer was due to convection. Heat transfer was due to convection. There also we have calculated the rate of heat flow, Q by T R H, and that is equal to small h A into difference in temperature. So this is conduction, this is convection. Now radiation. For radiation also, we have to define such. Similarly, for radiation also, we are going to define Q by T or H. See here, you can find a lead sphere. And this lead sphere is heated to a large temperature by a blacksmith who kept that in a furnace, and he heated to a large temperature, say some 120 or 150 degree centigrade. See, now from that hot lead sphere, thermal radiation will be emitted in all directions from its surface. So now first what we consider, the energy. Now we don't use the word heat energy. Instead of heat energy, we say radiant energy. The heat energy which is radiated is called radiant energy. So the radiant energy, the energy radiated in 1 second, that we will be consider, and that is called as energy flux. See here the definition. The radiant energy per unit time which is emitted, transmitted, reflected or received by an object is called radiant flux. So radiant flux or energy flux is equal to Q by T or H. Now this lead sphere is having some surface area. So here Q means you have considered the entire heat energy coming out, right? But here if you want to consider energy, heat energy, radiant energy coming from unit area, suppose then what you have to do? See, suppose it is having surface area. Its surface area is A. So from A surface area, Q by T energy is coming in second. For unit surface area, from unit surface area, how much energy is coming? 1 by A into Q by T. So for this we assign another physical quantity, and that is called as emissive power. Now, so let us define another physical quantity, emissive power. The energy flux emitted by unit surface area of a radiating body is called emissive power. So emissive power is equal to energy flux by surface area. So here we can write Q by T into A, and its SI unit is, in the numerator energy means joule, here area means meter square, time means second, joule by meter square second. Now let us consider some important and interesting points about the emissive power. Once again, you look at the hot lead sphere. From this hot lead sphere, thermal radiation, you find thermal radiation in all directions from its entire surface area. See, thermal radiation is nothing but electromagnetic wave. It consists of heat radiation is by means of electromagnetic waves. So electromagnetic waves are coming, but an electromagnetic wave has certain wavelength. Then here, what is its wavelength? See, here the thermal radiation has different, not a single wavelength. The thermal radiation coming from the hot body doesn't have a single wavelength, and it doesn't have, see here I have written, the thermal radiation at any temperature is not of one or a few wavelengths, but has a continuous spectrum from small to the long wavelengths. So it consists of a continuous spectrum of wavelengths from a part of ultraviolet to infrared. So it has a range of wavelengths. The thermal radiation consists of a range of wavelengths. Okay, this is one important thing we have to remember. Okay, so at a temperature, so it consists of several wavelengths. Now you want to increase its temperature, then what happens? Now you are considering thermal radiation at different temperatures. Suppose this is at some 120 degree centigrade, and suppose you have increased the temperatures to some 200 degree centigrade, what change you observe? So emissive power of a body increases with temperature. If temperature increases, emissive power also increases. So that is second point. And another third point. At a temperature, emissive power is different for different wavelengths, because just now we have said the thermal radiation consists of a series of wavelengths from ultraviolet to infrared. We have seen it consists of several wavelengths. So whether the energy released the emission, the radiant energy, whether the radiant energy is the same for all wavelengths? No. Let us look at the graph. See here a graph here, lamp filament in our houses, there will be tungsten filament, bulbs will be there, and its filament temperature is 2000 Kelvin, and from that thermal radiation is coming with a series of wavelengths. And see, all wavelengths are not having same radiation energy. See, at this wavelength, this much energy. See, first rising, reaching a maximum value, and again decreasing. See, the radiant energy is not uniform. If it is uniform, we get a horizontal line, single line, but it is first increasing, afterwards decreasing. So for different wavelengths, the radiant energy is different. For arc lamp, here you can see clearly. Arc lamp, its temperature is 3000 Kelvin, and its graph is like this. See, from here to here, as the radiation energy is very rapidly increasing and reaching a top value at a certain wavelength, and afterwards rapidly decreasing. So different wavelengths have, see, at this wavelength the radiant energy is this much, at this wavelength the radiant energy is this much, at this wavelength the radiant energy is the highest, and at this up to here. So as you move from left to right, the radiant energy first increasing, afterwards decreasing. So different wavelengths are having different radiant energies. So now, first we defined energy radiated in unit time, and that is called as energy flux. Afterwards, we defined energy radiated per unit time, per unit surface area, and that is called as emissive power. Now, see, the energy radiated, the thermal radiation coming in 1 second from unit surface area is consisting of a continuous spectrum from small to long wavelengths. It is having different wavelengths. Now, we should consider the radiation energy per second, per unit time, per unit area, and per unit wavelength range. So now, suppose you have taken wavelength on x-axis and emissive power on y-axis. You got a graph like this. And see, you can see the emissive power not uniform. Different wavelengths are having different emissive powers. Okay, now what you are doing, you have chosen a wavelength. That's why I have written under the E, I have written lambda. So you have chosen a certain wavelength. And from that wavelength, you are considering from lambda to lambda plus d lambda. From lambda to lambda plus lambda. So you have taken a range of wavelengths. You have taken a range of wavelengths. That is, this minus this gives how much? D lambda. So in this range, how much energy is emitted per second per unit area? So the area under the curve gives that. Okay, so over d lambda wavelength range, dE energy is emitted. Over unit wavelength range, how much energy is emitted? So 1 by d lambda into dE. So that gives So we define another physical quantity. So the range of energy divided by the range of wavelength as emissivity. Emissivity. So now we can define emissivity how? Emissive power per unit wavelength. Emissive power per unit wavelength is known as emissivity, and this emissivity is shown by small e letter. Now let me write definition for emissivity. Emissive power per unit wavelength is called emissivity, or radiant energy per unit time, per unit area, and per unit wavelength range is called emissivity. So this is the expression. Now we have another definition also. We define emissivity of a body as emissive power of the body at a temperature by emissive power of block body at the same temperature. And value of E lambda is between 0 and 1. E lambda depends on properties of surface. Now we are taking this cavity as a block body. The emissivity of a body is a function of wavelength and temperature. If cavity walls are maintained at a temperature T, the radiation that comes out of the cavity hole will be similar in spectrum composition to the radiation of a block body at the same temperature. So, as a block body, we are taking a cavity and experimentally at a temperature you have considered the intensity of radiation coming from the hole at different wavelengths. Taking the readings, you have drawn a graph. See, for this is for a temperature of 2000 Kelvin. At this temperature, the body gave radiation, the thermal radiation intensity. Emissivity means, emissivity also can be called as thermal radiation intensity. And the intensity is not uniform. At different wavelengths, the intensity is different. See, the intensity is gradually increasing with wavelength, afterwards decreasing with wavelength. So based on the experimental values, graph is drawn. So this graph is for this temperature. So let us consider first this graph, this single graph for a particular temperature. Number one, the area under each curve gives the emissive power of the block body at the corresponding temperature. How can you say? Because on y-axis you have taken E lambda, on x-axis you have taken lambda. So area means this multiplied by this, E lambda into D lambda. See here, we have defined E lambda is equal to D lambda by D lambda. By cross multiplying we get D E lambda is equal to E lambda into D lambda. So when you multiply E lambda by D lambda, you are getting emissive power. So the area under each curve gives the emissive power of the block body at the corresponding temperature. Next, the emissive power of a block body increases with temperature. Let us see the graph again. See, this curve is for 1600 Kelvin temperature. This curve is for 1790 Kelvin and this is for 2000 Kelvin. See, at a lower temperature, the area under the curve is lower. And at the higher temperature, the area under the curve is higher. So now you can say the emissive power increases with the temperature. Third one, the peak of the curve shifts toward shorter wavelength with increase in temperature. See, each curve is having a peak value. First, let us take this temperature 1600 Kelvin. At this temperature, the peak value is at this wavelength. See, let me write here A. Now, for a temperature TB, see, 1790 Kelvin, for this temperature, the peak value is occurring here. So, the corresponding wavelength is here. Let me write here B. See, the wavelength decreased. Here, temperature increased. Here, wavelength decreased. And now, let us consider another temperature, 2000 Kelvin. So, at this temperature, the peak is occurring here. And the corresponding wavelength is here. See, further the wavelength decreased. So, as temperature increased, the peak of the curve is shifting towards shorter wavelength with increase in temperature. It means there is inverse proportionality between these two. At 1600 Kelvin, maximum power is radiated at this wavelength. At 1790 Kelvin temperature, maximum power is radiated at this wavelength. And for 2000 Kelvin temperature, maximum power is radiated at this wavelength. Lambda m means wavelength at which maximum power is radiated. So, as temperature increased, the wavelength, the corresponding wavelength is decreasing. Is decreasing. At 1600, the wavelength corresponding to maximum emissive power is here, for 1790 here, for 2000 here. It means the wavelength is decreasing. As temperature increasing, wavelength decreasing. So I have written here the wavelength at which the maximum power or maximum intensity is emitted decreases as temperature increases. Or you can say in another way also, wavelength lambda m of maximum radiation is inversely proportional to absolute temperature. Because when temperature is increased, lambda m value is decreasing. Therefore, you can say lambda m is inversely proportional to absolute temperature. Or lambda m is equal to a constant of proportionality comes. And here B is called Wien's constant. And its value is 2.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meter Kelvin. See here, from this, B is equal to lambda m into T. lambda in meters, temperature in Kelvin, like that. Or lambda m into T is equal to B is equal to constant. So this is known as Wien's displacement law. So now I have written here Wien's displacement law. Wavelength for which radiant energy is maximum decreases with increasing temperature. That is, lambda m is inversely proportional to absolute temperature. Therefore, lambda m into T is equal to constant, and that value, constant value, is this much. Now, let us consider its applications. See, I have written wavelengths of thermal radiation in increasing order. See, if you move from left to right, wavelength increases. Here, ultraviolet, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red, infrared. Okay, now, color of a piece of iron. See, you must have seen at a blacksmith workshop there. Color of a piece of iron heated in a hot flame first becomes a dull red. First becomes a dull red, first here. Then reddish yellow. And finally white hot. So it means what? See, from red to yellow means you are moving in this direction. From left to right, wavelength increases, and from right to left, wavelength decreases. So as temperature is increasing, wavelength is decreasing. That is inverse proportionality. As temperature increasing, wavelength, corresponding wavelength, is decreasing. So here, this is verified with our Wien's displacement law. Now, another application. Surface temperatures of celestial bodies like moon, sun, stars can be determined. Making use of the Wien's displacement law, we can find surface temperature of moon, surface temperature of sun. See, being on Earth only, you were able to calculate the surface temperatures of celestial bodies. Really a great achievement by the scientist Wien's. How? Let us do some problems. Solar radiation was maximum at this wavelength. Find surface temperature of sun. So it means this is lambda m. One angstrom is equal to 10 to the power of minus 10 meters. Now, see the Wien's displacement law. Lambda m T is equal to constant, and that constant is 2.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3. Now, we want temperature. Temperature is equal to 2.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 by lambda m. 2.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 by lambda m is 4753 into 10 to the power of minus 10. So that is equal to 6060 Kelvin. So you determined the surface temperature of sun, 6060 Kelvin. See, this is only surface temperature. Interior temperatures are higher than this. So using Wien's displacement law, you can determine only surface temperature of your celestial body.